already started about this topic, that is sterilization techniques. And in that lecture, we have studied about the basic concepts about sterilization and disinfection, and then we have studied about the physical methods of sterilization. In today's lecture, we are going to study about the different types of chemical methods which are used for sterilization. So here, already we all know, or that we have seen in last lecture, why we need this sterilization, why we are going to sterilize different apparatus or equipments or glassware here. Then we have studied about different definitions, what is meant by sterilization, what is meant by disinfection. Then we have studied about the antisepsis, antiseptics, then bactericidal agent, bacteriostatic agent. See, there is a difference between this bactericidal and bacteriostatic. Sidal means here which have the killing effect, and static means here which have the effect on the growth inhibition. So bactericidal agent means agent which can kill bacteria, and bacteriostatic agent means agent or chemical agent which only prevents the growth of microorganisms or which prevents the multiplication of bacteria. So that's why it is called as bacteriostatic. Then we have seen about these physical methods of sterilization. In that we have studied sunlight, drying, then dry heat, which includes flaming, incineration or hot air. Then we have studied about the moist heat sterilization, which includes pasteurization, then boiling, steam under normal pressure, then steam under pressure, then filtration also, it is one type of physical method, then radiations as well as ultrasonic and sonic vibrations. So all these are the physical methods of sterilization. So today we are going to study about the chemical methods of sterilization. That is, these chemical methods includes the different types of chemicals, and that chemicals, these are used for sterilization purposes. So one by one we are going to see here. The first one is alcohols, which includes ethyl alcohol, isopropyl alcohol or trichlorobutanol. Then aldehydes, it includes formaldehyde and glutaraldehyde. Then dyes are there, halogens, phenols. Then surface active agents, metallic salts, and finally there are gaseous sterilizing agents are also there, which are used for sterilization, and that includes ethylene oxide, formaldehyde and beta propiolactone. So these are the gaseous sterilizing agents. So one by one we are going to see about these different chemical agents. But before that, when you are going to select that particular chemical as a disinfectant or as a sterilizing agent, then that chemical must have, or that antiseptic or that disinfectant or that sterilizing agent, it must have some properties, and having that properties will decide that particular chemical is an ideal chemical for sterilization. So which are that properties that must have or must possesses that particular chemical, antiseptic or chemical, that is disinfectant. So these are the different properties here. One is wide spectrum activity. So whatever that chemical we are using for sterilizing purposes here, that chemical must be effective against large number of microorganisms. So it must have wide spectrum of activity. Second one, it is active in the presence of organic matter. So if there is organic matter is present, so in such cases also that chemical sterilizing agent must be active, or it must kill that pathogenic or that microorganisms, or it must carry out that sterilization process. Then next property which should be possessed or present in that chemical sterilizing agent is, it is effective in acid as well as alkaline media. So when there is an acidic environment is there, at that time also that chemical should be effective for killing of that microorganisms. Or if there is an alkaline pH is there, at such situation or at such pH also, that chemical should kill that pathogenic or that microorganisms. Then speedy action. So whatever that action of this chemical sterilizing agent will be there, that should be fast. That is speedy action. The next one is your high penetrating power. So if that chemical sterilizing agent has the high penetrating power, so that can kill the microorganisms or that can kill the sterilize that particular environment inside the material. So if but when that chemical has the high penetrating power, then it should be stable. That means whatever that temperature of surrounding environment will be there, in that surrounding environment that chemical sterilizing agent should be stable. Otherwise what happens, that chemical will lose its antimicrobial activity. So that should not be happen. So that chemical should be stable. Then it is compatible with other antiseptics as well as disinfectants. Next one, it should not corrode the metals, because when you, if you are using that chemical sterilizing agent for the sterilization of particular metallic equipments, so that chemical sterilizing agents should not corrode that metallic equipments or that metals. So it not corrode the metals. Next property for ideal chemical disinfectant is it does not cause local irritation or sensitization. So that means it does not have or it should not have any side effects, that is irritation or as well as sensitization. Then not interfere with healing. Then next one, it should not be toxic if absorbed into circulation. Next ideal or property is it should be cheap and easily available. So whatever that chemical sterilizing agent having the cost, that cost should be less, or it must be easily available, so that the cost of that chemical will be less. And last one property of ideal chemical disinfectant is it should be safe and it should be easy to handle or easy to use. So all these are the properties of ideal chemical disinfectant. And when that particular chemical sterilizing agent it has such particular properties, then and then only this chemical agent can be used as a disinfectant, it can be used as an antiseptic, or it can be used as a sterilizing agent. So what are the modes of action of chemical disinfectants? Now we know that these different types of chemicals, they bring about the destruction or killing of microorganisms. But how these chemical agents or disinfectants or sterilizing agents, they bring about the killing of these microorganisms? So there is a destruction of proteins or protein coagulation, then it causes the destruction of cell membrane, which results in the exposure, damage or loss of the cell contents. Then it causes the removal of free sulfidryl groups, which is very essential for the normal functioning of the enzymes. So when there is a use of chemical sterilizing agent, so at that time this chemical sterilizing agent, they removes the free sulfidryl groups, and that which is very essential for the activity of enzymes. If there is a removal of sulfidryl group, then that enzymes cannot be function. Then next one is your substrate competition. So there is a competition between the resembling compounds, for example, that is for the substrate of the enzyme, and that diverts or that misleads the enzyme, which is necessary for the metabolism of the cell, and it causes the cell death. Because this chemical sterilizing agent and that substrate, so there is that enzyme, there is a competition to bind with that substrate. So instead of binding that substrate to the enzyme, that chemical compound get bind to the enzyme here. Okay, so this is the, or that enzyme get bind to the chemical substrate. So there is a competition is there, and that leads to the that is inhibition of metabolism of the microbial cell, and finally it causes the death of the cell. So these are some modes of action of chemical disinfectants. See, this is the first chemical sterilizing agent, that is alcohol, and in that ethanol. So 80% volume per volume ethyl alcohol, or 2 propanol, that is 60 to 70% volume per volume, or that isopropyl alcohol. So these alcohols, these are the solutions, and these are used for disinfection or disinfection of the skin, as well as to decontaminate the clear or clean surfaces. So this is the alcohols. So the spectrum, it is effective against fungi. So these alcohols, they are, or ethanols, they are effective against different types of fungi. They are effective against vegetative bacteria. They are effective against mycobacterium species. And these are also effective against some lipid containing viruses. So all of you know that the that is pandemic which is going on, COVID-19 pandemic. So this coronavirus, or that COVID-19 virus, or which is also called as SARS-CoV-2, it consists of lipid membrane, and we are using that sanitizer here which consists of 70% alcohol. So this 70% alcohol, it is useful for the killing or destroying of this coronavirus or this COVID-19 virus. So because it consists of the lipid, or this coronavirus, it is a lipid containing virus. So this is about the spectrum of these alcohols. So limitation, it is not effective against spores. Concentration, just as we are using in sanitizer, it is 70%. So the concentration of alcohol which is most effective, it is 70% in the water. That is, and caution, do not use near flames due because of flammability, because this alcohol or that sanitizer, it is inflammable and or flammable. So when he will take it towards the fire, so that will flammable, and may swell rubber or harden plastics. So these are some limitations or caution. See, this is the some figures here which shows the using of that alcohol for sterilization or disinfection or sanitization here. That washing of hands like this here. Next one, aldehydes. So in aldehydes, the most used sterilizing agent is formaldehyde, and that precautions are required for when there is a handling of this formaldehyde. Then formalin, which is a 37% formaldehyde or gas in water. So that is called as formalin. Then it is effective against most microorganisms. It is bactericidal in nature, that means it kills the bacteria. It is sporicidal, that it kills the spores, or it is viricidal, or it kills or destroy the viruses. Then 13% volume per volume formalin, it is a good decontaminating agent, but it has some irritating odors. Then 8% volume per volume formalin in 80% of alcohol is effective against the vegetative bacteria, spores, as well as viruses. And it does not corrode stainless steel. Means you can sterilize stainless steel materials or equipments by using these aldehydes. So uses of aldehydes includes, that is formaldehyde. It is used to preserve anatomical specimens and for destroying anthrax spores. So that is caused by the produced by the Bacillus anthracis, which is the causative agent of this anthrax disease in hair as well as in wool. So this formaldehyde, it is used to destroy these anthrax spores present in hair or wool. Then 10% formalin, which consists of 0.5% sodium tetraborate, it is used to sterilize clean metal instruments. Then formaldehyde gas, it is used to sterilize instruments. Then heat sensitive catheters, as well as for fumigation of hospital wards, sick rooms, as well as laboratories. Then it can also be used for clothing, bedding, furniture, and books. So then that formaldehyde, it is used for or to disinfect equipments, for example centrifuges or biosafety cabinets. See, these are some metal instruments or biosafety cabinets, clothing, bedding, furniture, as well as books, which can be sterilized by using this gaseous sterilizing agent, that is formaldehyde or formalin. Then fumigation technique is here, that is, that can be carried out with the help of this formaldehyde. As you seen in the that rainy season, that municipal corporation, they fumigate the drainages, because there is a production of large number of mosquitoes which causes the malaria or diseases. So that can be fumigated, or that operation theaters or that rooms or laboratories, these are fumigated with the help of this formaldehyde or that gaseous sterilizing agent. So how this fumigation is carried out? Now you are also watching here in many homes that in COVID-19 pandemic, that employees from the municipal corporation, they are fumigating that houses or that places where there is a positive patients are finding. So after sealing the windows and other outlets, formaldehyde gas is generated by adding 250 gram of KMnO4 to 500 ml of formalin for every 1000 cubic feet of room volume. What caution should be taken are the reaction produces considerable heat, and so heat resistance vessel should be used because it produces heat. Then after starting generation of formaldehyde vapors, the door should be sealed and left unopened for 48 hours. Then again, caution, when there is a use of formaldehyde can react with free chlorine to produce toxic gas. So remove hypochlorite solutions and hypochlorite acid from the spaces which is to be decontaminated. Then irritant vapors, these are released, therefore neutralize it with ammonia following or after decontamination. See, this is the figures which shows the fumigation, how that fumigation is carried out. Then next one is glutaraldehyde. So the concentration of glutaraldehyde, which is commercially available as 2% weight per volume aqueous solution, which must be made alkaline to activate, and that is by the addition of 0.3% sodium bicarbonate. Then 2% glutaraldehyde solution for at least 10 hours, it can be used to sterilize heat labile atoms or heat sensitive atoms. Then it is active against vegetative bacteria, it is active against spores, fungi as well as different types of viruses. So this is all about the glutaraldehyde. So use of that glutaraldehyde, it is used for instruments such as stethoscopes, then bronchoscopes, then corrugated rubber anesthetic tubes, face masks, then endotracheal tubes, then metal instruments as well as polythene tubing. So all these instruments that can be sterilized by using this glutaraldehyde. Caution, so this glutaraldehyde is known to cause dermatitis, that is a skin disease, and asthma. So less irritating, but it is less irritating than formaldehyde. Then that glutaraldehyde should not be used in an area with little or no ventilation, so there should be ventilation. Then eye protection, a plastic apron as well as gloves must be worn. Then it should be stored away from the heat sources and in containers with close fitting lids. Then the length of time that glutaraldehyde solutions can be used, it varies, but they are usually good for up to 14 days. Then solution should be replaced anytime they become cloudy. So this is about the glutaraldehyde, advantages of using glutaraldehyde, that is numerous use studies published, relatively inexpensive and excellent materials compatibility. There are some disadvantages are also there, and that includes pungent and irritating odor, relatively slow mycobactericidal activity, that is it has low mycobactericidal activity, and it coagulates blood and fix tissues to surfaces. So this is the glutaraldehyde, which is commercially available by the brand name, that is Sidex or Sidex. Then chlorine compounds, so generally used in the form of sodium hypochlorite. Then it is effective against a wide variety of microorganisms, that includes vegetative bacteria as well as viruses, and it is preferred for the disinfectant for HIV as well as hepatitis viruses. Then concentration, it is used at 0.1% as general disinfectant, and it is effective between pH range of 6 to 8, that is sodium hypochlorite. So there are some limitations are also there. It is less suitable in the presence of organic matter, for example blood, and concentration must be increased to retain the action. Then strength decreases on standing, which should there should be making of fresh solutions daily. Then high concentration covered metal surfaces and bleach and damaged fabrics. So this is hypochlorite, about the hypochlorite solution here. So these are inexpensive broad spectrum chlorine releasing disinfectants of choice against viruses including hepatitis B virus. And now if you are you can see on the sanitizer bottle also, there is a hypochlorite is written here. So that is also used for this COVID-19 pandemic also. Then aqueous solution of sodium hypochlorite, that is 0.25%, it is called as household bleach. Then it is used in concentration of 0.2 to 1% depending on the circumstances, and the caution should be taken here, because these hypochlorites, these are inactivated by organic matter, they cover metals, and therefore contact of the chemicals with metallic instruments and equipments that must be avoided. See, in case of heavy soilage, for example blood spillage, a concentration of 10,000 ppm, that is 1:5 ratio of household bleach, is available. Of available chlorine is recommended, and it has great widespread use as a laboratory disinfectant on surfaces of bench as well as in discarded spots. So this is the decontamination by using that hypochlorite solutions here. So large spills, large organic load, undiluted from bottle, then small spills, virus inactivation, and general surface disinfection. So these are the uses of some that decontamination by this hypochlorite solution. Then iodine compounds. So that iodine, all of you hear about that tincture iodine. So iodine, it is used in aqueous or alcoholic solution, and it is effective against many microorganisms. The concentration of iodine, which is usually diluted to 1% weight per volume, free iodine, then optimum pH, that is neutral to acid. Caution, it is not suitable in the presence of organic matter. Then stains skin and may cause irritation. Then it decomposes when heated above 40 degrees Celsius, and it do not use on aluminium or copper materials. So how that iodine is used here? So that is the method of using iodine. So it is diluted in alcohol for washing hands or used as a sporicide. Then prepare dilutions daily. Then it is used, most commonly used for skin disinfection and decontaminating of clean surfaces. Then iodophores, these are also the that products. They are replace the aqueous as well as tincture forms of iodine, because the side effects like staining and irritation are far less in iodophores as compared to the aqueous or tincture iodine. Then iodophores are chemical complexes with iodine which are bound to a carrier such as polyvinyl pyridine, pyrrolidone, that is pyridone or PVP, or ethoxylated non-ionic detergents. Then these are free microbicidal iodine. It is gradually released from these compounds. So these are the some branded materials or available packages of iodine. That is betadine. All of you hear about this betadine here. So that is the product of iodine. Then PVP in a dilution of 1:2 to 1:100 kills many bacteria including Staphylococcus aureus, but it may become contaminated by organisms like Pseudomonas. So that is the limitation. Then uses of iodophores are they used for antisepsis of skin, mucosa and wounds. Then 2.5% ophthalmic solution is an useful prophylactic against neonatal conjunctivitis. So this is the betadine, which is the brand name of iodine product here. So this is the chlorhexidine. So this chlorhexidine, as a chlorhexidine gluconate, it is dissolved in 70% alcohol and it is effective against gram positive organisms and HIV. An active pH range is 5.5 to 8. Limitation, it is not recommended as a general disinfectant, and it is not active against sporulating bacteria or non-liquid containing viruses. Then Savlon. So this is the chlorhexidine and cetrimide. And all of you hear about this Savlon also, which is a disinfectant. Then it is used in burns, wounds, as a bladder irrigant, and for surgical instruments and pre-operative disinfection of skin. Then it is also used as an antiseptic. Then apply alcoholic chlorhexidine to the skin in the event of accidental contamination or decontamination. Then hydrogen peroxide, or that is H2O2. So this is the hydrogen peroxide solution. Concentration of 3% weights per volume, used for disinfection, and it is active against large number of microorganisms. It is active against fungi, spores, as well as enteric viruses, and which require higher concentration. Then it is non-toxic end products of decomposition. So caution, do not use on aluminium, copper, zinc or brass. So what is the mechanism or how that hydrogen peroxide kills microorganisms? So this hydrogen peroxide on decomposition liberates or releases free hydroxyl radicals, and which is the active ingredient in this process. So this hydrogen peroxide, it is used for the disinfection of plastic implants, contact lenses, as well as surgical prosthesis. Then phenolics. So this is the Lysol. Again, it is available on medical here or in that grocery shops, Lysol. So it is the phenolic product, synthetic phenolics that can be used as a general disinfectant in the laboratory. Then it is active against bacteria and lipid containing viruses, but it is not active against pores and non lipid containing viruses. Then active in presence of organic matter. So what is the use of this phenolics here or that Lysol? So it is for disinfecting floors, walls, benches and furniture. Then Crisols. So methyl phenols or Lysols, all you hear about this, Dettol, then Lysol. So limitation, these are toxic to the skin and tissues, mainly used for preliminary sterilization of infected glassware in laboratory or disinfection of excreta, cleaning of floors of wards and operation rooms in hospital. Then chloroxylenol or dimethylphenol, it is an active ingredient of Dettol. So this is about the these brands which are available in the market. Then hexachlorophane, it is bacteriostatic, that means it inhibits the growth of microorganisms or bacteria, that's why it is bacteriostatic. At very high dilutions and used in soap and powder form, it is more effective against gram positive than gram negative bacteria, and it is applied on skin as prophylaxis against staphylococcal infection. So example is here chlorhexidine, which is already mentioned in previous slides. So this is about the chlorhexidine gluconate antiseptic, and which is used in mouthwash. Okay. Then quaternary ammonium compounds. So these are the quaternary ammonium compounds. These are positively charged surface active disinfectants. These are effective against gram positive bacteria and lipid containing viruses. Not recommended as general disinfectants. They have narrow antibacterial spectrum. That is, these quaternary ammonium compounds, these are effective against less microorganisms. Then inactivated by proteins, soap and anionic detergents. Example includes benzalkonium chloride, that is then alkyl dimethyl benzyl ammonium chloride and cetylipridinium chloride. Then these are used for the cleaning of floors of hospitals. Then ethylene oxide, it is an gaseous sterilizing agent. So it is an alkylating agent. It exerts lethal effects on the proteins of bacteria. Then it is gas at ordinary room temperature, and it is active against all types of bacteria as well as spores. It has got good degree of penetration power even through the plastics. So this is a gaseous sterilizing agent. Then ethylene oxide machine. So this is the ethylene oxide machine. So uses plastic goods, polythene tube, artery and bone grafts, cystoscopes, vaccines and culture media. So all these can be sterilized by using this ethylene oxide. Then these objects, these are kept in the cabinet from which the air is removed by a vacuum pump, and then a mixture of ethylene oxide and carbon dioxide is introduced into the cabinet or in that equipment which sterilizes all these materials. See, the next one is beta propiolactone or BPL. This is also a gaseous sterilizing agent. So it is a condensation product of ketone and formaldehyde having the boiling point of 163 degrees Celsius. It is capable of killing all microorganisms including viruses. What are the uses of this BPL or beta propiolactone? So this BPL has low penetrating power as a gas, but it is believed to be more efficient for the purpose of fumigation. Then it is biocidal, it has biocidal action, and it is very rapid, and only very less concentration, that is 0.2% BPL or beta propiolactone, is used for the sterilization of biological products. What are the limitations here? So this beta propiolactone, it has carcinogenic effect that it can cause cancer. then so this is about the point which is to be keep in mind when you are using this beta propiolactone. So that prepare fresh dilutions daily, use clean dry containers, use clean water for dilutions, then use higher concentration or for longer duration of spillages, then avoid using corrosive disinfectants on metal surfaces. So these are about the chemical sterilizing methods. So if you are not subscribed this Microbiology by Santosh Napte, so kindly subscribe this Microbiology by Santosh Napte YouTube channel so that you will get notifications when I will upload the new videos. Thank you.